Now let us discuss the chapter data handling. So what is the data? So before going to the topic data, we will look for the some information. Now in our day-to-day life, we come across some situations like if we want to find the information regarding the runs made by a batsman in the last 10 test matches, or if you want to know the information regarding number of wickets taken by a bowler in the last 10 ODIs, or if you want to know the students who passed in the mathematics test or if you want to know the information regarding the students who read story books in their leisure time. So in all these situations we are collecting some information. So the information collected in such cases is called a data. So we collect the information to study some situations. So the information collected in all these situations is called a data. If a teacher wants to know the average height of all the students in her class, then what does she do? She will measure the height of each student and she will note down the height of each student and she will organize the information, means the data, in a systematic manner. Then she will interpret according to the information. So the information collected in this case is also called a data. So in general, if you collect any information to study any situation, so that information collected is called a data. If any data is given to us, then we can represent the given data graphically to give the clear idea of what it represents. So then we can represent any data graphically by three graph diagrams. The first one is pictograph. The second one is a bar graph. And the third one is double bar graph. A pictograph means in this we represent the given information by drawing pictures, and in the bar graph we represent the given data by drawing the horizontal or vertical bars, means the rectangles. And in the double bar graph, yet we will compare the two informations by drawing respective rectangles for each information. Now let us see the first topic, a pictograph. So the first pictograph means the pictorial representation of a given data is called a pictograph. So the given information is represented by drawing pictures, then it is called as a pictograph. Now let us see the pictograph. Here one boy symbol stands for 10 boys. So if there are two boy symbols, then we can understand that there are 20 boys. Now in the different classes, in 6th, 7th and 8th class, the different number of boys are there. So in the 6th class, so there are three boy symbols, figures, means we can understand that there are 30 boys in 6th standard. So here 10 boys plus 10 boys plus 10 boys. So then we get 30 boys. Now, how many boys are there in 7th class? So there are only 2 boys figures. So then we can write that there are 20 boys in the 7th class. Then how many boys are there in the 8th class? So 1, 2, 3, 4. So there are 4 boys figures in the 8th class. So we can say that there are 40 boys in 8th class. Now let us answer the following questions. How many boys are there in class 7? So we can say that there are 20 boys in class 7. Because there are 2 boys figures, so we can understand that there are 20 boys. Now the second question, in which class are maximum number of boys? So in which class out of these 3 classes, 6, 7, 8, these 3 classes, in which class there are maximum number of boys? So we can easily say that in 8th class there are maximum number of boys. So there is a major drawback in the pictograph. For example, if in any class only 23 students are there, means 23 boys are there, then how can it be represented? So we cannot show the portion of the figure so that it represents 23. So this is the major drawback of the pictograph. So to overcome this drawback, to overcome this demerit, then the another graphical representation is there, that is bar graph. So in the case of bar graph, so we can represent any portion of the given data. So if any 18 boys are there or 12 boys are there, then for each corresponding number of boys, then we can show the rectangle accordingly. Now let us see the second type of graphical representation is, that is a bar graph. Now from the given figure, so the different bars means rectangles are drawn vertically. So on the horizontal axis we have taken the different academic years, and on the vertical axis we have taken the number of students in class 8. So in the academic year 2003 to 2004, the length of the rectangle means the length of the bar is 100. So we can understand that, so there are 100 students in the academic year 2003-2004 in class 8. So in the academic year, in the next academic year 2004 to 2005, so the length of the bar means the length of the rectangle is 200. So we can observe that there are 200 students in class 8 in the academic year 2004 to 2005. So similarly we can find the number of students in class 8 in the different academic years from 2003 to 2008. So by observing this graph, so we can answer the questions. What is the information given by the graph? So the information by this graph is the total number of students in class 8 in different academic years from 2003 to 2004 to 2007 to 2008. Then in which year is the number of students maximum? So in the last academic year, means 2007 to 2008, so this is the maximum length of the rectangle. So in this academic year there are 350 students, so the maximum students in the academic year 2007 to 2008. And in which year is the number of students minimum? So in the first academic year in the graph 2003 to 2004, the length of the bar is less, so there are only 100 students in the academic year 2003 to 2004 in class 8. Then if you observe each bar, the width of each bar is the same. So in a bar graph we can observe that the width of each bar is same, and the gap between each 2 consecutive bars also the same. So this is the gap between each 2 consecutive rectangles, so this is also the same in the bar graph. And then what does the height or length of each bar represent? But is it same? No, obviously we can say that no, because the height or length of each bar represents the particular value of the observation. So in the academic year 2007 to 2008, so there are 350 students in the class. So this height or length of the bar represents the number of students in that particular academic year. So here the height or length of each bar means each rectangle represents the particular category of the given information. But here the height of each bar is not same when compared with all other rectangles. Let us see the second type of graphical, third type of graphical representation. So double bar graph. So in the given double bar graph, on the horizontal line we have taken the different subjects, and on the vertical line, so marks obtained by a student. So in the two academic years, the unshaded rectangle represents the academic year 2005 to 2006, and the shaded rectangle represents the academic year 2006 to 2007. So in the two academic years, we can observe the marks obtained by a student in different subjects. So in the 2005-2006 academic year, in math subject he scored 30 marks. So immediately in the next academic year 2006-2007, he got 60 marks. So there is a lot of improvement in the subject maths when compared with these two academic years. So when you take the other subject, social science, so in the academic year 2005-2006, so this length of the bar 50 represents the marks scored by the student in social science, and here the next academic year 2006-2007, so he scored 55 marks, as the length of the rectangle represents 55, so he scored 55 marks in social science. Now, so there is a little improvement in the social science. So similarly, we can compare the marks scored by the student in different subjects. So in the two academic years, so those two academic years are 2005 to 2006 and 2006 to 2007. So this is the comparison between the two academic years, the marks scored by a student in different subjects. So here, like this, the double bar graph is used to compare the two different informations. Now let us answer the two questions. So what is the information by the double bar graph? So we can get the information, the marks scored by a student in two academic years in the different subjects. Now in which subject the performance improved the most? So seeing the first subject, mathematics, so when compared with 2005 to 2006 and 2006 to 2007, he scored 30 marks more than the previous academic year. So we can understand that his performance is the most in mathematics in the two academic years. Now let us go to the next topic, organizing data. So what is organizing data? So if you collect any information from any source, then it will be unorganized form, means it is not yet organized. So for example, if you collect the information regarding the favorite subject of any group of students, then so for example, arts, mathematics, English and science. So if you want to find the information from the students regarding the favorite subject of their, then arts, mathematics, English and science in different four subjects, then they will say, so different choice. So the particular student may like art, or any other student may like mathematics, and some students may like English, and some other students may like science. So but this is not yet organized. So this data is called raw data. So what is raw data? The information available to us in an unorganized form is called a raw data. But to draw the meaningful inferences from any data, we need to arrange the data systematically. So for example, if some group of students are there, so they are asked to write their favorite subject. So the given subjects are arts, mathematics, English and science. Now the different students are giving different choice. So A, the particular student gives arts, and then M, then again A, E, S, E, M. Here A stands for arts, M stands for mathematics, E stands for English, and S stands for science. Then again, some other students are giving their choice, which they like: English, arts, mathematics, science, English, science, mathematics, arts, 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 mathematics, science, English, again English, mathematics, arts. So there are totally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. So there are 23 students. Now let us organize the same raw data systematically by using the tally marks. So in the first column, we are taking subject, and in the second column we are taking tally marks, and in the third column we are taking number of students. So there are four subjects, which are arts, mathematics, English, and science. Now, how many students like arts? Do you like arts? Means we can find the number of A's in the given raw data. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there are 7 students who like arts. Means arts is the favorite subject of 7 students. So we can draw the tally marks like 1, 2, 3, 4. Then when you get the 5th student, then cross it. Then again, more 2 tally marks. Then how many students like mathematics? So let us count the mathematics now. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 students like mathematics. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, then 5th one cross it, and more one is required, so 6th one. So then how many students like English? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So once again we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 students like English. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6th one. Then how many students like science? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, then 4. So 4 students like science. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if you find the total number of students, 7 plus 6 13, 13 plus 6 19, 19 plus 4 23. So there are totally 23 students in that particular group. So the 23 students like different subjects. So 7 students like arts and 6 students like mathematics and 6 students like English and the last 4 students like science. So this is an organized form. So from this table we can find the number of students, particularly who like arts, who like mathematics, and those who like English, and those who like science. Now here 7 is the frequency from this. So here the number of students who like arts is 7. So this is the frequency of the particular subject arts. Means this frequency gives the particular number of students who like the particular subject arts. So from this 6, we can understand that 6 students like mathematics. So here the total number of tally marks in a particular category is called the frequency of that category. So here the total number of tally marks in the category mathematics is 6. So here 6 is the frequency of this category mathematics. So here in the category English, so there are 6 tally marks. So the total number of tally marks in the particular category gives the frequency of that category. Now this table is called frequency distribution table. So your frequency gives the number of times that a particular items occurs. So your arts subject 7 students are there, means so the 7 students like particular subject arts. So here the frequency of the subject arts is 7. So similarly the frequency of the subject mathematics is 6. Let us go to the next topic, grouping data. So if you take the information regarding the choice of the subjects, so means different subjects, so then we can represent it by a pictograph or a bar graph. But if the data is given like this, means here these are the marks of 60 students, so which was conducted out of 50 marks in a mathematics test. So then the marks of 60 students are given, so they got different marks out of 50. So this information is so lengthy. So if you want to represent this information, this data, by distribution, frequency distribution table, so it will be very lengthy because we have to represent the marks of 60 students in a column. So then it will be too lengthy. Then we will arrange all these marks in different groups. So let us take the different groups such as 0 to 10 and 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, then 40 to 50. So these are groups with 0 to 10 means, so this is a group, the marks from 0 to 10. So if any students got 5 marks, then we will include the student in the group 0 to 10. So if any particular student got 25 marks, then you will include the student in the group 20 to 30. So in the first column we will take groups, and in the second column we will take tally marks, and in the third column we will take number of students. Means frequency of the particular group. So this number of students are also, we can say that frequency. Then we can take the last group as 50 to 60 also. Now from the given information, we have to find out how many students have scored the marks from 0 to 10. So let us, we have to count. So how many students are there who scored 0 to 10? So to find the number of students from 10 to 20, so we have to count, we have to observe how many students have got the marks from 10 to 20. So we have to find the number of students that occur in the different groups. Okay. If you count the number of students from 0 to 10, means the number of students who got 0 to 10 marks, so there are 2 students, and from 10 to 20, so there are 10 students, those who got 10 marks to 20 marks. So here 2 students means we can draw 2 tally marks. So in this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th. So 5 plus 5, 10. So here 21 students are there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one, 1, 2, 3, 4, then 5th one cross. So there are 19 students who got 30 to 40 marks. So we can say that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th. And there are 7 students who got between 40 and 50. So then we can show 7 by tally marks, 1, 2, 3, 4. So there is only 1 student from 50 to 60, that is only 1 tally mark. Now from this table, we can easily say that how many students have scored marks in different groups. Means from 20 to 30, how many students are there? From 30 to 40, how many students are there? And from 40 to 50, from 50 to 60, we can find out easily seeing the frequency table. So this table is called grouped frequency distribution table. So from this table we can say that most of the students have scored the marks from 20 to 40, because from 20 to 30 maximum students are there, then from 30 to 40 also there are maximum students 19. So from 20 to 40 the maximum students got totally 21 plus 19, 40 students, and the least number of students in the group 50 to 60. So there is only one student in the group 50 to 60. So in the groups 0 to 10, 10 to 20, the starting value 0 is called the lower class limit. And the end value 10 is called upper class limit. And each group 0 to 10, 10 to 20, this each group is called the class interval. So this each group is also called class interval. Or simply we can say that classes, class intervals or classes. And the difference between the upper class limit and the lower class limit is known as the length of the class or size of the class, or simply we can say that class size. So the difference between the upper class limit and the lower class limit of any class. So 20 minus 10 is 10, or 30 minus 20 is 10, or 40 minus 30 is 10. So here 10 is the class size. So class size means the difference between the upper class limit and the lower class limit of any particular class. Then if you observe the classes, class intervals like 0 to 10 or 10 to 20 or 20 to 30, here 10 occurs 2 times. So here we will have a doubt that if any particular student got 10 marks, then in which group he does belong to, whether he is included in the group 0 to 10 or 10 to 20. But by convention, we will include the student in the higher class, means 10 to 20, but not in the 0 to 10. So here, we will include the students only from 0 to 9, but not 10. So if any particular student got 10 marks, then we will include the student in the class 10 to 20. Similarly, if a student got 30 marks, then we will not include the student in 20 to 30. So in the upper, in the higher class, we will include him. So he belongs to the class 30 to 40. So if any student got 50 marks, then where does he belong to? So he belongs to the class 50 to 60, but not 40 to 50. So this table is called grouped frequency distribution table, because here all the marks are arranged in different groups, like 0 to 10, 10 to 20, and 20 to 30. And from this table we can interpret, so each group, how many students are there and how many students have got less than 30, or how many students have got more than 50. For example, if you want to find the number of students who got less than 30, so less than 30 means, so before this we have to add all the values. So these 19 students got from 30 to 40. So before 30, 21 plus 10 plus 2. So 21 plus 10, 31 plus 2, 33. So 33 students got less than 30. And how many students got more than 40? So more than 40 means, so after 30 to 40 you have to take. So after 30 to 40, we can take from 40 to 50 and 50 to 60. So here 7 plus 1, 8. Now here 8 students got more than 40. 7 plus 1, 8 students have got more than 40 marks in the table. Let us see the next topic. Bars with a difference means a histogram. Now let us take the same grouped frequency table, like class intervals and frequencies. So the marks of 60 students conducted in a mathematics test out of 50 marks. So there are 2 students in the class 0 to 10 means from 0 to 10 marks there are 2 students, and from 10 to 20 10 students are there. So like this in the different classes, so the different number of students are there. If we show the same thing using bars means rectangles, so in the first class 0 to 10, so 0 to 10 there are 2 students, so we can take on the horizontal line we are taking marks of the students, and on the vertical line we are taking the number of students. So by taking these two on the horizontal line and the vertical line, we can show the rectangles that represents each class. So in the first class 0 to 10, so there are 2 students. So and in the vertical line we are taking the multiples of 2. So because if you take 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on, so each rectangle comes very lengthy. So that is why you are reducing on the vertical line. So we are taking the multiples of 2. So then the first class frequency is 2. So we can show the first class 0 to 10 as a rectangle whose length is 2 units. And the second class 10 to 20, the second class interval is 10 to 20. So the frequency of the second class is 10. So we can show that the length of the second rectangle is 10. Next, the length of the third rectangle means the frequency of the third rectangle is 21. So the third class 20 to 30 is 21. So we can take between 20 and 22. So this is 21, and the next class 30 to 40 is 19. So this is exactly between 18 and 20. The next class 40 to 50, the total number of students who got 40 to 50 is 7. So there are 7 students in the next class 40 to 50. So 7 means between 6 and 8. and from 50 to 60 there is only one student. So between 0 and 2, now if you observe all these rectangles, so there is no gap between each two consecutive rectangles. So there is no gap between any two consecutive bars. So this type of bar graph is called histogram. So as there is no gap between any two consecutive classes, so here also there is no gap between any two consecutive rectangles, means bars. So this type of graphical representation is called a histogram. So in this histogram we have taken the class intervals on the horizontal line and the frequencies, corresponding frequencies on the vertical line. So if you take another case, another situation, that ages of 25 teachers of a school. So we are taking the age of the teachers in years on the horizontal line and the number of teachers on the vertical line. So on the horizontal line we are taking from 20 and we are taking each unit as 5 years, so 20 to 25, then 25 to 30 and 30 to 35. So here the jagged line or broken line represents that, so there are no teachers from the age group 0 to 20. So between 20 years there is no teacher, that is why, so this part is shown as the broken line or jagged line. And on the vertical line we are taking the number of teachers as 1, 2, 3. So here we are taking each unit represents one teacher. Then from the age group 20 to 25 years, so there are 4 teachers, and in the age group 25 to 30 years, so there are 5 teachers. So differently, so in different age groups the number of teachers is given as the length of each rectangle. So if you count all these, if you add all these, then you will get the total number of teachers as 25. 4 plus 5, 9, 9 plus 6, 15, 15 plus 3, 18, 18 plus 2, 20, plus 5, 25. So there are 25 teachers in the school in the different age groups. So here also we are taking the rectangles without any gap in between them. So as there is no gap between the age groups of the teachers, so because we are taking 20 to 25 and immediately 25 to 30, and 30 to 35, so there is no gap between each two consecutive class intervals. So here also in the histogram there is no gap between any two consecutive rectangles. So here the length or height of the rectangle represents the particular number of teachers in that age group. So here the height of this rectangle 4 represents that the total number of teachers in the age group 20 to 25 is 4. So the height of the rectangle or length of the rectangle 6 represents that, so there are 6 teachers in the group 30 to 35 years. So far we have discussed the bar graph, pictograph and double bar graph and then histogram. Now let us solve some problems. The shoppers who come to a departmental store are marked as man means M, woman means W, boy means B, and the girl means G. The following list gives the shoppers who came during the first hour in the morning. So make a distribution table using the tally marks and then draw a bar graph to illustrate it. So this is the list of the shoppers who visited the shop in the morning hour. So we have to draw the frequency table, then we have to show the same thing as the bar graph. So first we will draw the frequency distribution table. So in this first you have to take the shopper as the first column. Then tally marks, then frequency. So the different shoppers are woman, man, boy and girl. So then we write the total. First, let us count how many women visited the shop in the first hour in the morning. So let us count the women in the given list. 1, here W represents the woman. So we will count the number of W's in the given list. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So there are 20 women. So the frequency of the shopper woman is 20. So here we have to draw 20 tally marks. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one. 1, 2, 3, 4. So 5th one cross the 5th one. Again 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So there are 4 sets of each 5. Then 5 4s are 20. So there are 20 women visited in the first hour in the morning. Then you will count how many M's are there. Here M represents the number of men visited. So you will count the number of M's in the given list. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are 10 men. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one cross it. Then 1, 2, 3, 4. So 5th one you have to cross it. Then the total tally marks are 10. Now let us count how many boys visited the shop in the first hour in the morning. So then we will count the number of B's here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So there are 15 boys who visited the shop in the first hour in the morning. So we have to draw 15 tally marks to show the 15 boys. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there are 3 sets of each 5 tally marks. So totally 3 5s are 15 tally marks. Next, girls. Yeah, G represents the number of girls. Here we will count the girls in the list. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there are 5 girls. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one cross it. So the total number of shoppers visited is 20 plus 10, 30, 30 plus 15, 45, 45 plus 5, 50. So totally 50 shoppers visited the shop in the first hour in the morning. So this is the frequency distribution table showing the shoppers visited. So different shoppers as woman, men, boy and girl. And the frequency of each category. So the number of women visited is 20 and the number of men is 10 and the number of boys is 15 and the number of girls is 5. Now again we have to draw the bar graph to illustrate it. So we have to draw the bar graph. So we will take both vertical line and horizontal line. So this is origin, both horizontal and vertical line intersect. Now the first category is woman. So its length is 20. So in the on the horizontal line, we will take the shopper. And on the vertical line, we will take the number of shoppers, means frequency. So here I will take frequency. Then first, what is the first shopper? The first type of shopper, woman. So its frequency is 20. So on the vertical line, you will take the multiples of 5. So if you take 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on, so to represent 20, it will be very lengthy. So that's why you are taking the multiples of 5. So then the first category is woman and its frequency is 20. So we will take equal intervals on the horizontal line. The first category is 20, so the woman in the second one, so this stands for woman. In the second one is men, so its frequency is 10. And the third one is boys, so its frequency is 15. And the next one is girls, its frequency is 5. So we can take here each rectangle represents the different category of shoppers. So the first rectangle represents the woman and the second rectangle men, third rectangle boy and the fourth rectangle girl, and the frequencies are written above each rectangle. So there are 20 women who visited the shop, and there are 10 men visited the shop, and there are 15 boys who visited the shop, and there are 5 girls who visited the shop. So this is called a bar graph to represent the given information. Let us see the next question. The weekly wages in rupees of 30 workers in a factory are given. So using tally marks, make a frequency table with the intervals as 800 to 820, 820 to 840 and so on, and draw a histogram. So the wages, the weekly wages of 30 workers are given in a list in rupees. Now first you have to make the frequency distribution table, then we have to draw the histogram. So first in the frequency distribution table, we will take the first column as the class intervals. The second column has tally marks. And the third column, frequency. So the classes are given as 800 to 820 and 820 to 840 and so on. So the first class interval is 800 to 820. The second class interval is 820 to 840, then 840 to 860, then 860 to 880. So the last class is 880 to 900. So then we will take the total. Now let us see each wedge belongs to which class interval. So first value is 830, so it belongs to 820 to 840, so one tally mark is written against 820 to 840 class. Then next one is 835, so 835 also belongs to this class. The next class is 890, so 890 goes to 880 to 900. Next class 810, so 810 goes to the first class 800 to 820. Next 835, so 835 goes to the next class 820 to 840. Next 836, 836 also comes in the same class. The next 869, so 869 belongs to 860 to 880. Next 845, so 845 belongs to 840 to 860. The next 898, so 898 belongs to 880 to 900. Next 890, so 890 also belongs to the same class. Next 820, 820 belongs to 820 to 840, but not 800 to 820. So here we should cross it because this is a fifth tally mark. Next 860, 860 belongs to 860 to 880, but not 840 to 860. Next class 832, so 832 belongs to 820 to 840. Next 833, so 833 also belongs to the same class. Next 855, so 855 belongs to 840 to 860. Next 845, so 845 belongs to 840 to 860. Next 804, it belongs to the first class 800 to 820. Next 808 also belongs to the same class. Next 812 belongs to the first class, and 840, so 840 belongs to 840 to 860. Then next 885 belongs to 880 to 900. Next 835, so 835 belongs to 820 to 840. Again 835 belongs to the same class. Next 836, 836 belongs to the same class, 820 to 840. Then next 878, so 878 belongs to 860 to 880. Next 840, so 840 belongs to the class 840 to 860. Then 868, so 868 belongs to 860 to 880. Next 890, 890 belongs to the class 880 to 900. Then 806, 806 belongs to the first class 800 to 820. Then 840, 840 belongs to the class 840 to 860. Now we will find the total frequency of each class interval. So the class interval 800 to 820, there are 5 tally marks, means there are 5 workers in this class interval. So here the frequency of this class interval 800 to 820 is 5. Then the frequency of the next class interval 820 to 840 is 5 plus 5, 10. The next frequency means the frequency of the next class interval is 5 plus 1, 6. The frequency of the next class interval is 4. And the frequency of the next class interval is 5. So if you add all these frequencies, the total frequency is 5 plus 10, 15. 15 plus 6, 21. 21 plus 4, 25. Plus 5, 30. So totally there are 30 workers in the factory. So if you distribute the wages in the classes, like class intervals, the wages are from 800 to 820 and 820 to 840 and so on. So then the frequency of each class interval is in the last column, in the third column. So this is called a frequency distribution table. It shows the number of workers in particular class interval. Now we have to draw the histogram. So while drawing histogram, we have to take the wages on horizontal line and the number of workers on the vertical line. So we will take on the horizontal line, we take wages in rupees, and on the vertical line we take the number of workers means frequency. On the vertical line, we will take the multiples of 2. Six, 8, 10, 12, 14, and 16. So to draw the histogram, there will be no gap between any two consecutive rectangles. And here we are taking from 800 to 820, the first class interval. So we have to draw the jog line, because 0 to 820 we are not showing anything here. So the first class is from 800 to 820 and its frequency is 5. So the first rectangle, the height of the first rectangle is 5. So this is 800 to 820, and its frequency is 5. So there are 5 workers whose wages are 800 to 820. And how many workers are there whose wages between 820 to 840? So there are 10 workers from 820 to 840. So as there is no gap between any two class intervals, so there will be no gap between any two adjacent rectangles. So this is 820 to 840. The frequency of the next class is 840 to 860 is 6. So the frequency of the next class is 6. So this is the class 840 to 860. And the next class frequency is 4. So we will draw the next class interval 860 to 880. And the frequency of the next class is phi. So that is the class 880 to 900. So this is a histogram showing the different class intervals and of different frequencies. So on the horizontal line, we have taken the wages as the class intervals, and on the vertical line, we have taken the number of workers as the frequencies. And here each rectangle represents the range of the wages from 800 to 900 rupees. So far we have discussed regarding the bar graph, double bar graph, pictograph and histogram. Now let us go to the next topic, circular graph or pie chart. Have you ever seen the data represented in the circular form? So a data can also be represented using circle graph or pie chart. Let us take an example to understand it easily. The time spent by a child during a day is given in a circular form, and here the whole circle is divided into sectors, and here each sector represented by an activity of the child during a particular day, like sleeping, school, play, homework and others. Now the child is spending 8 hours during the sleeping, and the child is spending 6 hours during school, and 3 hours in play, and 4 hours in homework, and 3 hours in other activities. Now how to divide a circle into sectors? Means, so in the circle graph or pie chart, the whole circle is divided into sectors. Now here each sector represents an activity or an information given in the data. Now let us find what is the size of each sector in the circle. So how the circle is divided into sectors? Here the size of each sector is proportional to the information in the given data. So here the size of the sector representing sleep and size of the sector representing school. So this all, the size of each sector is proportional to the value, means proportional to the value in the given data. Now let us find the whole day, means 24 hours. Here 24 hours is divided into 8 hours, 6 hours, 3 hours, 3 hours and 4 hours. Now you will find the proportion of the time in sleep. Proportion of the sector representing sleep equals to, so here it is represented by 8 hours, means number of hours in sleep by whole day. So the number of hours in sleep is 8 hours. So whole day consists of 24 hours. Here hours get cancelled, and 8 ones are 8, 8 threes are 24. So this is 1/3 of the whole circle. So the proportion of the sector representing sleep is 1/3 of the whole circle, and we will find the proportion of the sector representing school. Equals to number of hours in school by whole day So the number of hours in the school is given that 6 hours. So your whole day consists of 24 hours. Your hours get cancelled and here 6 1s are 6, 6 4s are 24. So this equals to 1 by 4. So here we can understand that the size of the sector representing school is 1 fourth of the whole circle. So the size of the sector representing sleep is 1 third of the whole circle. Then what is this angle? What is the angle represented by the sector sleep? And what is the angle represented by the sector school? Now let us find the angle represented by sector of sleeping. So here 1 third into the total angle at the center is 360 degrees. So 1 third into 360 degrees, then we get 3 1s are 3 and 3 1s are 3 2s are 6, 3 0s 0. So this equals to 120 degrees. So here we can see that it is 120 degrees. Then what is the angle of the sector school? So this is 1 fourth of the whole circle. So we will find the angle 1 fourth of the whole circle means 360 degrees. So this equals to 4 1s are 4, 4 9s are 36, 0. So this equals to 90 degrees. So the angle of the sector school is 90 degrees. So this is right angle 90 degrees. So similarly we can find the angle of each sector made at the center. Here the circle graph is known as pie chart. So it represents the relation between the circle and its the whole circle and its parts. Here the whole circle is divided into sectors. So that is why the circle graph shows the relation between the circle and its parts. Now let us see how to draw a pie chart or a circle graph. So the one question, the favorite flavors of ice creams for students of a school is given in percentages. So the flavors are given the chocolate, vanilla and other flavors, and the percentage of students preferring the flavors. So 50% of the students prefer chocolate and 25% of the students prefer vanilla and 25% of the students prefer other flavors. Now we will draw the another table. So to find the proportion of each sector representing chocolate, vanilla and other flavors. So your first column we will take the flavors of the ice creams, chocolate, vanilla and other flavors. In the second column we will take the percentage of students preferring the each flavor. So your chocolate is preferred by 50% of the students and vanilla is preferred by 25% of the students and other flavors are preferred by 25% of the students. So then we will find the fraction of each sector representing chocolate, vanilla and other flavors. Now 50% means we can take 50 by 100, so this equals to 1 by 2, and 25% means 25 by 100, so this equals to 1 by 4, and the other flavors 25%, so this 25 by 100, this equals to 1 by 4. So the sector, the proportion of the sector representing chocolate is half, one half of the whole circle. And the proportion means size of the sector representing vanilla is 1 fourth of the full circle. And the size of the circle means size of the sector representing other flavors is 1 fourth of the whole circle. Now we will find the fraction of 360 degrees. So 1 by 2 means 1 by 2 into 360. So this equals to 180 degrees. Means size of the sector representing chocolate is 180 degrees of the whole circle. So the size of this sector is 180 degrees at the center, and the vanilla is 1 fourth of the whole circle. So you will take 1 by 4 into 360 degrees. So this equals to 90 degrees. Next, other flavors 1/4. So here also 1 by 4 into 360 degrees. So this is also 90 degrees. So angle of the sector representing chocolate is 180 degrees, and angle of the sector representing vanilla ice cream is 90 degrees, and angle of the sector representing other flavors is 90 degrees. Now let us draw these three sectors in a circle. So first you draw a circle with any center and any convenient radius. Now let us draw a circle with center O and any convenient radius. Now draw a radius OA, then draw 180 degrees. So 180 degrees means it is a straight angle. So from O we draw a straight angle. So angle AOB is 180 degrees. So this sector represents chocolate. So this is exactly half the circle, means it is a semicircle. The next sector angle is 90 degrees. So draw a right angle. Now this sector is right angle representing 90 degrees, and this is represented by vanilla. And the obviously the angle of the third sector is 90 degrees. So this is also right angle, and this is represented by other flavors. So in this way the whole circle is divided into some sectors representing each information given in the data. Now let us solve a problem. Draw a pie chart showing the information given below. The table shows the colors preferred by a group of people. So yeah, in the table the first column is given as the colors and the second column is given as the number of people. Means here 18 people prefer the color blue and 9 people prefer the color green, and red color is preferred by 6 people and yellow color is preferred by 3 people. So the total number of people is 36. Now let us extend this table to draw the pie chart or circle graph. So in the next column you will take in fraction. And the next column, the fourth column, has the central angle or in 360 degrees. So the total number of people is 36. So if you represent the number of people preferred blue color as the fraction, then we can take 18 by 36. So this equals to 18 ones are 18 and 18 twos are 36. So this equals to 1 by 2. And the green color preferred by 9 people. So if you write 9 by 36, so this equals to 1 by 4. And 6 by 36 is equals to 1 by 6, and 3 by 36, so this equals to 1 by 12. Now we will find each fraction in 360 degrees, means we will find the central angle represented by each sector. So here 1 by 2 into the angle at the center in a circle is 360 degrees. So we get 1 by 2 into 360 is 180 degrees. Next, 1 by 4 into 360 degrees. So this equals to 90 degrees. Next angle, 1 by 6 into 360 degrees. So this equals to 60 degrees. Then 1 by 12 into 360 degrees equals to 30 degrees. So if you add all these angles, then you will get again 360 degrees as the central angle at the center of your circle. So 180 plus 90, 270. 270 plus 60, 330. 330 plus 30 is 360 degrees. So the total angle at the center is 360 degrees. So here we got angle of each sector made at the center of the circle. Then first we will draw a circle with any center and a convenient radius, and draw a radius OA, and the angle of the sector representing blue color is 180 degrees. So we have to draw the straight angle. So this is 180 degrees. So this represents the information blue color, which is preferred by 18 people and making 180 degrees at the center. And the second information is given as green color, which is preferred by 9 people and having the central angle at the center 90 degrees. So we have to draw a right angle . So this is right angle 90 degrees. So this is represented by green color. And the next information is red color. It is preferred by 6 people and having the central angle at the center is 60 degrees. So this angle is 60 degrees and it shows the information red color. And automatically the next sector makes 30 degrees at the center, and it is represented by yellow color. So your blue color is preferred by 18 people, so we can write here 18. And green color is preferred by 9 people. Red color is preferred by 6 people. And yellow color is preferred by 3 people. So in this way, a circle is divided into different sectors. So that is why a circle graph or a pie chart shows the relation between a circle, the whole circle, and its parts. Let us see the next question. A survey was made to find the type of music that a certain group of young people liked in a city. So the pie chart shows the findings of the survey. So the some young people, means 40% of the young people like light music, and 30% of the young people like folk music, and the 10% classical music, and 20% semi-classical. So answer the following from this pie chart. So if 20 people liked classical music, then how many young people were surveyed? So you have to find out the total number of young people surveyed. So to find the total number of people surveyed, it is given that 20 people liked classical music. So the observe the sector representing the classical music, it is given that 10%. Here 10% represents 20 people. So here for 10% represents 20 people. Then we have to find out 100% represents how many people. So we can take 100 by 10 into 20. So you can cancel 0 and 0. So here 100 into 2, 200 people. So the total number of young people surveyed was 200. So out of 200, so 20 people means 10% people like classical music. Next, which type of music is liked by the maximum number of people? So by observing the given pie chart, we can easily say that the size of the sector representing light music is larger. So we can say that the light music is liked by the maximum number of people. So it is maximum 40%. So all other given values are less than 40%, which are 20%, 10% and 30%. So the maximum number of people like light music. Next, if a cassette company were to make 1000 CDs, how many of each type would they make? So if a cassette company wants to make 1000 CDs, then you have to find out how many cassettes to be made of each type of music. So first you will find the light music. So it is 40%, so we can take that 40 by 100 into the total number of cassettes to be made is 1000. So this equals to 0 and 0 cancel, 0, 0 cancel, this equals to 40 into 10 is 400. So they have to make 400 CDs of light music. Next we will find the number of folk music cassettes. So it represents 30%. So 30 folk means 30 by 100 into the total number of cassettes is 1000. Here also two zeros cancel, then we get 30 into 10 is 300 cassettes. Then we can find classical. So classical music represents 10%. Here 10 by 100 into the total number of cassettes is 1000. So we can cancel two zeros and two zeros. Then 10 into 10 is 100. So they have to make 100 CDs of classical music. Then the last one is semi-classical. It represents 20%. So 20% means 20 by 100 into 1000, which is the total number of CDs. So here we can cancel two zeros and two zeros, and 20 tens are 200. So they have to make 200 CDs of semi-classical music. So far we have discussed the pictograph, bar graph and the double bar graph, and also the pie chart means circle graph, and we have done some problems regarding all these graphical representations. Now let us shift to the topic chance and probability. So if you take an example in our everyday life, for example during the rainy season, if you bring the umbrella to the school regularly, it may not rain. On a particular day, if you forget to carry the umbrella to the school, then suddenly it may rain. So this may happen sometime. If you take the another example, like if you go to the railway station in time, so on that particular day the train may come late. So in all these experiments we cannot decide a result. Well, it may happen or it may not happen. So in all these experiments we can say that the results have the equal chances of occurring. Now the next topic is getting a result. You might have seen that before a cricket match starts, so then the two captains of the two teams will go out and they will toss a coin. Then they will decide which team has to bat the first. So you are tossing a coin. For example, if you and your friends are playing a cricket match and you have to decide which team has to bat the first, then what you will do? You will toss a coin and then you will decide that you should bat first or your friend should bat first. So if you toss the coin, can you decide which either tail or head comes first? So we cannot decide, because you cannot decide either tail comes or head comes. So the experiment which we cannot decide which outcome will comes, so that is called a random experiment. And here the two possible, either the tail or head, so these two are called outcomes. Here we can consider that the tossing a coin is a random experiment, and in this getting a tail or getting a head, so these two are the possible outcomes in this random experiment. Now consider a wheel. Now what are the possible outcomes in this spinning wheel? So here the outcomes, possible outcomes are A, B and C. And if you consider another example, you have a bag of with 5 identical balls. W means white, R means red, B means blue and G means green and white, Y means yellow. So out of these 5 identical balls, if you pull out a ball from the bag, so then what are the possible outcomes here? So here also 5 possible outcomes are W, R, B, G and yellow. So these are the 5 balls which are the possible outcomes. Now let us discuss, so what are the equally likely outcomes? Now let us do an experiment. If you toss a coin and several times, then you will notice the possible outcomes occurring in each time. Now for example, if you toss the coin for 50 times, and if you notice that, so the head is as the outcome 27 times and tail is the outcome of 23 times, and if you toss the same coin for 60 times, then we can notice that head is occurring 28 times and the tail is occurring 32 times. Now what is the difference between the number of heads and the number of tails in the first case? So it is 4. And even in the second case, when you toss the coin for 60 times also, the difference is 4. And in the third case, if you toss the coin for 70 times, so then the third case also, the difference between the number of heads and the number of tails is 4. And as you increase the number of tosses more and more, so then the difference between the number of heads and the number of tails will be closer to each other. So here the difference is 4, and here the difference is 2, and in the last case the difference is 2. So the difference will be reduced as you increase the number of tosses more and more. So at some time the difference will be 0, then the number of heads will be equal to the number of tails. So means in this experiment we can observe that the number of heads and the number of tails will be equal. So when you increase the number of tosses more and more, means the chance of occurring heads and tails are equal, means the two possible outcomes, head and tail, so these two outcomes have the equal chances of occurring. So this can also be done by using the die. So if you take a die and throw it on every face, 1 to 6 numbers will be written. So here the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you throw the die for several times and increase the number of times throwing the die. So then we can observe that. So these all possible outcomes have the equal chances of occurring. So such outcomes are called equally likely outcomes. So here, in tossing a coin, the occurring of tail or head. So these both outcomes can be considered as equally likely outcomes. And in throwing a die, the possible outcomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these outcomes also can be considered as the equally likely outcomes. Let us see the next topic, linking chances. To probability. Now we will consider an example, tossing a coin. If you toss a coin, then what are the possible outcomes here? Possible outcomes are either head or tail, and these are the two equally likely outcomes, and these two outcomes are also called equally likely outcomes. Because either head come up or T may come up. Now what is the chance of getting head in case of tossing a coin? So now let us write the chance or probability of getting head in case of tossing a coin. Probability of getting head. So this equals to 1 by the total number of possible outcomes are 2. So we can say that 1 by 2 is the chance of getting head. And then what is the chance of getting tail in the same experiment tossing a coin? Now let us write probability of getting tail. So here also, 1, the chance of giving head is 1 and the total number of outcomes are 2. So this equals to 1 by 2. So either the probability of getting head or the probability of getting tail, so both are equal to 1 by 2 in the experiment, means in the random experiment tossing a coin. Now let us take another example. Throwing a die. So when you throw a die, here 1, 2, 6 numbers are written on each face of the die. So on a on each face 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 numbers will be written. So then what is the probability of getting 1? Here the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And these are equally likely outcomes. So when you throw a die, either 1 can come up or 2 can come up or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. So that is why these 6 possible outcomes are equally likely. So then what is the chance of getting 1? Means what is the chance of coming 1 up in throwing a die? is equals to 1 by the total number of possible outcomes 6. So we can write 1 by 6. Here 1 is the chance of giving 1 up and 6 is the total number of outcomes. Then what is the chance of, means probability of coming 5 up. So this equals to, so there is only one chance of coming 5 up. So then 1 by the total number of outcomes are 6. So we can say that 1 by 6 is the chance of coming 5 up. Now let us see the next topic, outcomes as event. Now you already know about outcome of a random experiment. Now let us see what is the event. Now here each outcome are the collection of outcomes. Of an experiment is called an event. So, if you take an example, tossing a coin. In the experiment, tossing a coin. So what are the possible outcomes? Tail or head. Now what is the probability of getting a tail? So that is 1 by 2. And what is the probability of getting a head? So that is also 1 by 2. Here each outcome, getting a tail or getting a head, is an event of this random experiment. Or if you consider the second experiment as throwing a die. So yeah, the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here getting 1 or getting 2, getting 3, getting 4, 5 or 6. So getting of each of these possible outcomes is called an event. So here each individual outcome, or sometime we have to take some collection of outcomes. For example, in the same experiment as throwing a die, so the probability of getting an even number. So here this is not an individual outcome. So this is the collection of outcomes, because there are 3 even numbers out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the even numbers are 2, 4, 6. So here 2, 4, 6. So these are the 3 even numbers. So then this equals to probability of getting an even number is 3 by the total number of outcomes 6. So this equals to 1 by 2. So this is the collection of outcomes. Either 2 can come up or 4 can come up or 6 can come up. Now then what is the probability of getting an odd number? Now the possible odd numbers are 1, 3 and 5. So this equals to, there are 3 odd numbers. So the collection of these 3 possible outcomes. So this is considered as an event. So this equals to, here also we can take that 3 by 6. The number of odd numbers out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is 3 by the total number of outcomes 6. So this equals to 1 by 2. So this is also considered as an event. So yeah, the probability of getting an even number or the probability of getting an odd number, so these two are the events in this random experiment throwing a die. Now let us discuss how the chance and probability are related to real life. Now we can say the two points which are very important of chance and probability related to the real life. So the first one is to find the characteristics of a large group by using a small part of the group. So during the election, an exit poll is taken. So in that case, so they will go to the polling centers and they will take the opinion of the small group of people, because they cannot take the opinions of all the people. So they will take some sample people. So they will choose some people and they will take their opinion. So based on that opinion, and then they will generalize the trend in the election, and they will choose the which party will win the elections. So and the second example is that meteorological department predicts weather by observing trends from the data over many years in the past. So meteorological department, how they will predict the weather? They will take the decisions predicting the weather. So far we have discussed the possible outcomes and equally likely outcomes and the random experiment and the chance and probability related to the real life. Now let us solve some problems. So the first question, list the outcomes you can see in these experiments. In this, the first question is spinning a wheel. So the spinning wheel, in this the outcomes are A, B, C, D, A. But here the possible outcomes are A, B, C and D. So here the possible outcomes are A, B, C and D. Now tossing two coins together. So when you toss a coin, means a single coin, then the possible outcomes are either tail or head. But when you toss two coins, so here I'm taking coin 1 and here coin 2. If you take two coins, either the first coin can give head and the second coin also can give head, or both can give tail, or either the first coin can give head and the second coin tail, or the first coin can give tail and the second coin can give head. So these are the four possible outcomes when you toss two coins together. So either both heads or both tails, or the first coin head and the second coin can give tail, or the first coin tail and the second coin head. So these are the four possible outcomes when you toss two coins together. Let us solve the next question. When a die is thrown, list the outcomes of an event of getting. So when you throw a die, so what are the total possible outcomes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So these are the 6 possible outcomes. So out of these 6 possible outcomes, you have to find out a prime number. So what are the prime numbers of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? We know that 2, 3, 5 are the prime numbers. So in this case, the possible outcomes are 2, 3, 5. And next, not a prime number. So what are the other numbers than prime numbers? So we can take, because 1 is neither prime nor composite, so we can take 4 and 6. Next, a number greater than 5. So out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what is the number greater than 5? It is 6. So the possible outcomes outcome is 6. Now not a prime number. So here 1 is not a prime number. It is neither prime nor composite. So but according to the question, not a prime number means, so we can take 1, and the other numbers which are not prime are 4 and 6. So So here 1, 4 and 6 are the not prime numbers. Now next question, a number greater than 5. So what are the possible numbers greater than 5 out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? So there is only one possible outcome, that is 6. So your possible outcome is 6. And next, a number not greater than 5. A number not greater than 5 means we have to write the numbers greater, less than or equal to 5. So your possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So these are the numbers which are not greater than 5. Let us solve the next question. Find the probability of getting ace from a well-shuffled deck of 52 playing cards. So in the well-shuffled deck of 52 playing cards, so there are 4 ace cards. So the number of ace cards equals to 4, and the total number of cards equals to 52. Now the probability of getting ace card equals to the number of ace cards 4 by the total number of outcomes, so means the total number of cards 52. So if we cancel, 4 ones are 4 and 4 ones are 4, 1 is left here, 12, 4 threes are 12. So this equals to 1 by 13. So the probability of getting an ace card from well shuffled deck of 52 playing cards is 1 by 13. Next question. Find the probability of getting a red apple. So in the given circle, so how many apples are there totally? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there are 7 apples. So out of 7 apples, how many red apples are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. So there are 4 red apples. And the total number of apples equals to 7. Now the probability of getting a red apple equals to the number of red apples 4 by the total number of apples, means the total number of outcomes 7. So the probability of getting a red apple is 4 by 7. Okay, we'll solve the next question. When a die is thrown, find the probability of the following events. So the first question is a prime number. So out of the possible outcomes 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. So what are the prime numbers? So we can say that 2, 3, 5. So these three are the prime numbers. Now the probability of getting a prime number equals to the number of outcomes possible by 3 divided by the total number of outcomes 6. So here 3 ones are 3, 3 twos are 6. So this equals to 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 is the probability of getting a prime number. Now not a prime number. So what is the probability of getting a number which is not a prime number? So the numbers which are not prime numbers are 1, 4 and 6. So these are the three possible outcomes in this experiment. Now the probability of getting a number which is not prime equals to, here also three outcomes are there, so 3 by the total number of outcomes 6. So this equals to 3 1s are 3 and 3 2s are 6 equals to 1 by 2. So here 1 by 2 is the probability of getting a number which is not prime. Now next question, a number greater than 5. So here the possible outcomes are only one number, that is 6. Now the probability of getting a number greater than 5 equals to, so there is only one possibility, 1 by the total number of outcomes 6, so that is 1 by 6. Now a number not greater than 5, so what are the numbers not greater than 5? Means the numbers which are less than 5 are equal to 5, means 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So there are 5 possibilities. Now probability of getting a number which is not greater than 5 equals to, the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 by the total number of outcomes is 6. So the probability of getting a number which is not greater than 5 is 5 by 6. We will solve the next question. If you have a spinning wheel with 3 green sectors, 1 blue sector and 1 red sector. So what is the probability of getting a green sector and what is the probability of getting a non-blue sector? So in a circle, now 5 sectors are there of equal size. In that 5 sectors, there are 3 green sectors and 1 blue sector and the other red sector. Now we have to find the probability of getting a green sector. So the probability of getting a green sector equals to, so how many green sectors are there? 1, 2, 3. So there are 3 possible green sectors by the total number of sectors, means the total number of outcomes 5. 3 blue, 3 green sectors and 1 blue sector and the other red sector. So there are 5 sectors, so 3 by 5. So 3 by 5 is the probability of getting a green sector. Now let us find the probability of getting a non-blue sector. Probability of getting a non-blue sector equals to, a non-blue sector means, so the other sectors 1, 2, 3, 4, so there are 4 sectors other than blue. So the 4, the possible outcomes 4 by the total number of outcomes 5. So here 4 by 5 is the probability of getting a non-blue sector. Then what is the probability of getting a blue sector? So there is only one blue sector, so we can take that the probability of getting a blue sector is 1 by 5. Then what is the probability of getting a red sector? So there is only one red sector out of 5 sectors, so the probability of getting a red sector is also 1 by 5. So we can write that probability of getting a blue sector, equals to 1 by 5, and also the probability of getting a red sector also 1 by 5. Let us see the next question. Numbers 1 to 10 are written on 10 separate slips, one number on one slip, kept in a box and mixed well. So one slip is chosen from the box without looking into it. So what is the probability of getting? So there are 10 slips. On each slip, the numbers 1 to 10 are written, and they are mixed well, and all the 10 slips are kept in a box. Then if you choose one slip from the box without looking into the box, then what is the probability of getting a number 6, and what is the probability of getting a number less than 6, and what is the probability of getting a number greater than 6, and the probability of getting a one digit number? So let us take the first question. What is the probability of getting a number 6? So we have to get the number 6. So the possible outcomes is only 1, and the total number of outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 10. So there are 10 outcomes. So the probability of getting 6 equals to 1 out of 10. So there is only one possible outcome out of total 10 outcomes. Now the next question, a number less than 6. So what are the possible numbers less than 6? So we can take that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these are the 5 possible outcomes when you choose a number which is less than 6. So the probability of getting a number less than 6 equals to the possible outcomes 5 by the total number of outcomes 10. So we can take 5 ones are 5, 5 twos are 10. So this equals to 1 by 2. And the next question, what is the probability of getting a number greater than 6? So what are the possible numbers which are greater than 6? So they are 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are 4 numbers which are greater than 6. So in this 5 numbers are there, but here there are only 4 numbers. So the probability of getting a number greater than 6 equals to, so there are 4 possible outcomes, 4 by the total number of outcomes 10. So you can cancel, 2 2s are 4 and 2 5s are 10. So this equals to 2 by 5. The next question, what is the probability of getting a one digit number? So what are the one digit numbers 1 to 10? So up to 9 all are single digit numbers. So there are 9 one digit numbers from 1 to 10. So here we can take that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So these are the possible outcomes of a one digit number. So there are 9 outcomes, 9 possible outcomes out of 10 outcomes. So probability of getting a one digit number equals to 9 by 10. So then what is the probability of getting a two digit number? How many two digit numbers are there from 1 to 10? So there is only one two digit number, that is 10. So then the probability of getting a two digit number is 1 by 10. So there is only one two-digit number out of 10 numbers. So we can take that the probability of getting a two-digit number is 1 by 10.